This is Holy Cross Sunday. And so the lessons for this Sunday are different from the ones that are ordinarily used for this particular Sunday, which is really the 17th Sunday of Pentecost. But I think it's appropriate that we do, at all times and all places, and I'll be talking about that, live by the cross of Christ in every place that we are. And I'd like to begin by telling you a little story. I'm not going to be puberty, I'm sure. From time to time, I'll be like that, a little story about a prisoner who was being transferred from one correctional facility to another. And the man who was taking was a correctional officer whose name was John Bolton. And what Mr. Bolton noticed about this one prisoner was that he had a cross around his neck. But he also realized that this prisoner, as far as he could tell, was not a very religious person. So he looked a little more closely at this cross. And when he looked closer, he kind of came down to the guy who was looking, and he noticed the prisoner began to cover it up. So he wondered why he was covering the cross, and as the man removed his hand, he could see there was a little protrusion across, out of the top of the cross. He thought, well, that's kind of odd, so he asked about it. And the prisoner said, well, that's my good luck charm, and it's shaped in the form of a spoon for sniffing cocaine. Well, Mr. Bolton thought about that. And as he did, he began to, with a little experimentation, what he discovered was that this little protrusion at the top of the cross was a key. And the key unlocked nearly all the handcuffs that he could find. So what had happened was this fellow developed or devised this little cross key in the hopes of people not seeing, recognizing what it was, and use it for his escape. And there were many of these. Well, I think the message or the lesson of this little story about the cross key is this, that there really is only one cross key. And it isn't the one that this prisoner developed. It's a different kind. It's the cross that really makes a difference. It is the only key that will free us from sin. It's the only key that will free us from guilt. It's the only key that will free us from the power of Satan. Nothing else will work. Unfortunately, there are many people today who are more concerned about temporary freedom of the body rather than being concerned about real freedom of both body and soul. Whether a person is inside the prison or outside the prison really doesn't matter. Because what's important is all people, whether they're in jail or out of jail, need the cross of Christ. Nobody doesn't need the cross of Christ because it alone sets us free. Well, there are lots of demands on this cross of Christ. Go back into ancient history, ancient Jewish history, what we discover is that they demanded signs. Signs that somehow would overwhelm them and lead them into salvation. For them, the whole concept of repentance was purpose, unfortunately. It mattered. They were interested in signs. But then let's turn our attention to the Greeks. The ancient Greeks approached the whole thing very differently. They were very logical, practiced logic and wisdom and intellect, those kinds of things. Their plan of salvation had to be reasonable, it had to be logical, and it had to be rational. They wanted the wisdom of God to be empirically proven to them. You show me, I think all those Greeks were from Missouri. You show me, and I'll believe. They did not understand, because you see, for them, they wanted this, they couldn't understand why the wisdom of God was as it was. Who in the world would follow the Via Dolorosa? If you've been to Jerusalem, know what that is. The way of sorrows. The path that Jesus took when he carried his cross. That did not make sense. It was illogical for them to do that. Well, people today, all these years later, seek to find salvation in various ways. Lots of different ways. They try to find salvation through social justice or through environmental concerns. Or they may seek it in New Age spiritualism, which is on the rise. Many different ways of seeking salvation apart from following this shepherd Jesus. Well, the fact is, all of these ways that I've mentioned, none of them can be met, none of these demands can be met by Jesus. That isn't how he works. Jesus operates by the cross and no other way. See, when we think about the cross, we have to realize that the cross is God's unique plan. It's his unique idea. Nowhere in history has that ever happened, except through Christ. Remember what the Bible says that it is to the Jews? Anybody remember? It's a stumbling block. That's right. It's a stumbling block to the Jews. We're told that in many ways. You see, the Jews were looking for a Messiah, one who would be powerful, one who would kick out the Romans, set them free again to be their own people. They were looking for a Messiah that the Bible never said would come. So they were looking in all the wrong places for their salvation. See, they couldn't believe that a shepherd dying on a cross could lead people to salvation. Couldn't happen. That's at least what they believe. And the Greeks. And the Greeks again, with their peculiar approach to things. Remember it said in our text today that to the Greeks it was foolishness. Utterly foolish. To follow Jesus, to believe in salvation through his death. Yet for them, for the Greeks, it was untenable that a man, that God, would become a man. And then come and live the way he did, suffer the way he did, die the way he did for our salvation. That's simply illogical. And if you think about it, what Jesus did is illogical. It defies logic. And yet, that's exactly what God chose to do. He had a plan for his people, for us. For them, a crucified criminal could not be the Savior. Couldn't be. And that's exactly what we can do with Christ. The crucified criminal. It's illogical. The logic of Jesus' atonement and his knowledge of salvation is wiser than the most brilliant philosophers. You think about those such as Plato, Aristotle, and many, many others. What God is saying in his word this morning is that for all of their wisdom, it's nothing compared to God. How many times in our lives do we live as though though the gospel were more about the stumbling block for us, or more foolishness. Sometimes we get ourselves caught in that, and we forget the power that is God for our salvation. There's a story about a man a long time ago who had a Model T, and he was driving along in the middle of the road, and his car quit running. So he was out tinkering with the car, trying to make it start, and he was adjusting the spark and doing all the things under the hood he was trying to do with the timing work. Then a limousine came up, pulled up alongside, and stopped. And a wiry old man got out of the car. He says, "Are you having trouble?" "Yes, I can't get my car started." He says, "Well, let me take a look." So he gets under the hood, he tinkers around with the car for a while. He says, "Now try it." So the man tried it, and sure enough, the car started right up. Well, the man who helped this fellow out was none other than Henry Ford. And he said, "I built this thing, so I know how it works, and I know how to fix it." But isn't that also true of our God? I created it. I know how it works, and I know how to fix it. God says, "I know how to fix your broken lives. The sin that is a part of your lives, and the hurt and the pain, I can fix it." And yet, how many people do not trust Him to fix it, but go anywhere and everywhere but to the one who can fix our lives? So, you and I lift high the cross. We've been baptized. We've been instructed in God's Word. We receive the sacrament of Holy Communion. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, we are convinced of the truth of Jesus. And so we know that the cross is the sign of real wisdom. It's a sign of God's salvation. Now, the fact is, 1997, you and I, as Christians, in the eyes of the world, appear somewhat foolish. When we lift high the cross, they scoff. They laugh at us. When we lift high the cross in song and in our lifestyle, they say, no, you're all wrong. On Sunday morning, we can sing until our voices grow tired and weak. The other 6.5 days of the week, we are to lift high the cross of Christ in everything that we say and think and do, wherever we are, or whom we ever act. We know that this weakness, this foolishness, is the only way to God. Because you see, there is no salvation in anyone apart from Christ. It just doesn't exist. The world needs to hear through our lips, through our lives, Jesus Christ is Lord. That His death on the cross is the key to the way of salvation. There is a story I read about King Louis XII of France, and it seems that before he was made king and ascended the throne, he had been put in jail. And when he got out of jail and became king, and he was treated that way, when he became king, many of his cohorts, people with him, urged him to go after those who had persecuted him. But what Louis did was an interesting thing. He made up a list of all the people who had done anything against him. And on the list, behind each name, put a little red cross. Well, these people heard about what he had done. He had made this list up. Well, they really got afraid, and they were ready to run for their lives. Well, what Louis was doing was, King Louis, actually referred to him as Louis, I suppose. What King Louis was doing, however, was freeing each of those guilty people for what they had done. offering them was forgiveness. This is what the king said. The cross which I drew beside each enemy was not a sign of punishment, but a pledge of forgiveness, extended for the sake of the crucified Savior, who upon his cross forgave his enemies and prayed for them. It's very important that in our day and age, that we live by the cross and remember what the cross is. It's a symbol of death. It's a symbol of a gruesome, horrible death. We don't ever want to forget what that cross has prayed as that beautiful brass that's here, the one I have around my neck, and many others. It's a symbol of death. And that symbol of death is a constant reminder that our salvation did not come cheaply. It did not cost you and me anything, but it cost God. We must never forget the cost that it was. The death of Christ means exactly one thing: our freedom and our life. May the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, keep your hearts and minds to faith in Christ Jesus, life everlasting.
Those who are shut in and unable to be out in the midst of society, particularly those who are shut in. sometimes he wasn't from him. Well, for a water, a friend of Judy's story. September 17th, she will undergo a 4.5 to 5 hour surgery, take out a rib, and put it in the back. For Lord, she has unique problems, and she was born without arms or legs. We ask that you would guide the doctors as they perform this delicate operation. Give them courage to face this ordeal. Be with her parents through this tense time as well. Give them confidence that you are present with their daughter. Lord, we ask for that same confidence and presence in him or me. That as she deals with the cancer now returned to her body, that she might have the peace that can only come from you and your love and your care for her. We ask that the doctors might properly treat this cancer, to cause it to be in remission, your will be removed permanently. But whatever the outcome, Lord, we ask that she would trust and have confidence in you, that her parents, night and morning, be patient and lay on you as well. For how hard it is for parents to see their children suffer in any way. The Lord, as it is pleased you to summon from this world solo and slowly, our fellow member and friend, we praise you for all the blessings bestowed on our community's life, especially for the strength you gave him in his illness. Above all, we thank you for having brought him to faith in you as his Savior. Give your continued strength to his wife, Abel. Teach us all to remember our day, that we may apply our hearts to wisdom, to be saved by the mercy and merit of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Lord, we remember Carl Rieger, whose condition continues. How long it has been for him to suffer, and yet we know that you've been beside him with him. As you are with Kevin Rieger in his day-to-day struggle to regain strength and energy and the use of his legs, patience, trust him, to wait on you in your time. As we pray our prayers this morning, we are reminded too of the great prayer of you taught us as we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace.
And if I were a Baptist, I'd say, amen. I'm not. I won't do that. I'd like to invite you to remember first if you'd buy tickets for the dinner. Make sure you see Chuck. And to invite all of you, if you're not already going, to Bible class in the fellowship hall. And I believe there's coffee in there too. So even if you can't stay for Bible class, at least have a cup of coffee and God bless you.
Thank you.